students? How are you doing? How is life over there? Hope you are still safe. Don't forget to wash the hands. And if possible, you can even sanitize. Welcome to this fourth lesson of our topic soil. In the previous lesson, we had Mr. Ejunari discussing very important information about soil, humus, and mineral salts. Now, in this particular lesson, we are going to look at soil living organisms. Now, when you look at, like we said in the very first place, when we're introducing this topic, we said soil is a living system. Reason being, it contains a lot of living things. Now, it is important for us to look at these soil living organisms. Now, soil living organisms, they are grouped into two. We have microorganisms, and we also have macroorganisms. Microorganisms, these include the bacteria, the fungi, and they play an important role when it comes to maintaining soil fertility. Last time, we had Mr. Junai talking about humus. The humus which is formed, that humus is formed as a result of decomposition, and this decomposition is primarily done by the soil living organisms, most especially the bacteria and the fungi. Now, soil fertility can also be improved by bacteria in a way that they convert the free nitrogen in the atmosphere into nitrates, and by doing that, they make the nitrogen available to the plants. And in the other last lesson, I think it is going to be in lesson 6, we are going to see how this can happen. Now, when it comes to macroorganisms, these ones, first of all, they are large and they include roots of higher plants, earthworms, and soil arthropods. Now, when it comes to these large macroorganisms, the macroorganisms, they are important because they improve soil aeration and the drainage. Now, when you look at that next slide, we have some earthworms. Now, let's go to importance of soil living organisms. How are these living organisms important to the soil? The first point we can talk about is improving soil fertility. I think I already talked about this in my explanation in the previous slide. And these living organisms, like the earthworms, they burrow in the soil, and this improves on the aeration. I'd also hinted on this. Then some living organisms in the soil can cause diseases to man and his plants. We have seen the bacteria, we have seen the fungi. Those living organisms, they can cause diseases to man and his plants. Then the wastes from the soil living organisms, wastes from the earthworms, wastes from the soil arthropods, these wastes can form humus and eventually they improve on soil fertility. Now, on the next slide, you try to look at that link, try to watch, there is a video which is summarizing all that information. Now, let's go to an experiment to investigate the presence of living organisms in the soil. Which experiment can we perform to investigate, to find out that soil sincerely contains living organisms? Now, before you look at any experiment, you must be having the materials to use. And then in this case, the materials we are going to use, we have two conical flasks, we have two muslin bags, topsoil sample. The reason as why we are considering this topsoil sample is just because of one reason. The topsoil has so many living organisms. Then we have two corks and lime water or the bicarbonate indicator solution. Now, of course, after looking at the materials, the next part is looking at how the steps we are going to take when performing this particular experiment. Now, our first step, we are going to collect a handful of fresh topsoil sample. And we shall divide this sample into two portions. So we are going to call these two portions portion A and portion B. Now what we are going to do, we are going to sterilize portion B. How do we sterilize? By heating that soil sample for about 30 minutes. I just want you to imagine what will happen during that process of heating. Now after heating, we are going to leave this soil sample to cool, and eventually we are going to place it in the muslin bag. Now, after placing that soil sample in the muslin bag, our next step is going to be, we are going to place the other remaining portion. Remember, we had two portions. We sterilized the portion B, and then the portion A was not sterilized. Now we are going to place that portion A in another muslin bag. Now after that, we are going to add equal amounts of lime water or the bicarbonate indicator. Students, don't use these two at the same time, lime water or bicarbonate indicator solution. If you're using lime water is the calcium hydroxide solution. Now, if you're using lime water, use lime water only. If you opt for the bicarbonate indicator solution, use that one. Now, we shall add equal amounts of those in the conical flasks and then suspend the muslin bags with soil samples. Remember, in the procedure 2 and 3, we placed soil samples in the muslin bags. Now, after that, we shall suspend these muslin bags containing the soil samples in the conical flasks as shown in the next slide. Now, after that, we shall allow the setup to stand for about 2 days. Now, this setup, it is showing we have setup A and setup B. In setup A, we have fresh oil in the muslin bag. Then in setup B, we have heated soil in the muslin bag. Remember, I told you the reason as why we heat it is just to sterilize it, to make sure that the soil living organisms in that particular sample are killed. Now, let's move to the observations. What are we going to observe in this particular experiment? Now, this is what we are going to see. For that student who's going to use lime water, the lime water is going to turn milky. And for that other student, it could be Ayebo, it could be Austin, it could be any other student, the bicarbonate indicator is going to turn yellow in conical flask A. But now when it comes to conical flask B, the lime water is going to remain clear. Now, what can we conclude about this? We can make our conclusion based on the observations we have got. Now, we realize that carbon dioxide was produced in conical flask A or in setup A during respiration, and that one indicates the presence of living organisms. In setup A, we saw lime water turning milky. For lime water to turn milky, it means that there is carbon dioxide being produced. And where does this carbon dioxide come from? This carbon dioxide is coming from respiration by the living organisms in the soil. So that one is an indication that the soil in setup A has some living organisms that are respiring to produce this carbon dioxide gas. Now when it comes to lime water in flask B, it remained clear. Why? Because the living organisms, the soil, they were killed by heating. Remember, in one of our procedures, we talked about sterilizing the soil in setup B. Now, let's move to the next slide. This one is talking about types of soil. Now, soil is grouped based on size and nature of the soil particles. Now, on this basis, we have three types of soil, and this include, we have clay soil, we have loam soil, and then we have sandy soil. Students, ask yourself, how does these three types of soil look like? For example, how does clay soil look like? If you are near an anthill, can you go there and you pick some soil You call that one to be your soil sample. When you're moving along the road, more so these Maram roads, usually we have ways where the water passes alongside the roads. That side, we have that side where we can obtain our sandy soil. If not, you can even get this sandy soil from the construction sites. They usually use it for construction. And can you think of where you can obtain loam soil? That is your task. Now, let's begin by talking about sandy soils. Now, sandy soils contain large spaces between the particles, and these spaces allow water to drain off very quickly. What does this statement mean? What does it mean? Sandy soil has very many air spaces between the soil particles. Very many air spaces between the soil particles. Now, sandy soil has a greater feel when wet and felt between the thumb and the finger. Students, that word is not figure, that word is finger. Like the way I'm demonstrating, when you try to feel sandy soil between your thumb, this is the thumb, and the finger, you're going to have a greater feel. They contain only very small quantities. They contain only very small quantities of water, and they may be deficient in calcium and magnesium. And students, they are also described as light soils because they are relatively easy to work with. And that slide is giving us an example of sandy soil, which was obtained from the construction site near our school. Now let's move to clay soil. Clay soil has small fine particles. The particles in clay are closely packed. They are closely packed together, leaving very small spaces between them. This causes clay soil to have poor water drainage and also become waterlogged. They are difficult to work with and therefore described as very heavy soils. They have a sticky feel when wet. When you get clay soil and then you try to feel it in between your thumb and the finger, it has a sticky feel. Now, when lime is added to clay soil, the small clay soil particles aggregate to form bigger particles. Now, how can we improve the drainage? Because we saw it has that problem of becoming waterlogged. How can we improve on the drainage of clay soil? By adding in humus. And by the way, we saw that this clay soil has small spaces in between the particles. We can also improve its aeration by still adding a humus. Now that is a picture of clay soil around our school, and here we are trying to do some improvement on that clay soil. Now let's move to loam soil. Loam soil is a mixture of sand, silt, organic matter, and clay. So it is a mixture of all those components. Now we are having some example of loam soil there. Now let's move to the differences between clay soil and sandy soil. Now we had already discussed something concerning these two. Sand having large air spaces, for clay it has small air spaces between the particles. When you look at clay, it has high water retention capacity, it has high water holding capacity, which is not the case for the sandy soil, for it has very low water holding capacity. Clay soil has poor drainage. It has poor drainage. And then the other one, for the case of clay, sorry, sand, for it has good water drainage and many others. Now let's move to the physical properties of soil. We shall watch some video about the soil properties over there. Now let's begin by talking about porosity. And we are going to compare this porosity in the three types of soil. We realize that clay, sandy soil possess large spaces between the soil particles, and so that one makes it be more porous. Porosity means the spaces between the particles, the soil particles. Now, what about clay soil? Do you realize that clay soil has very small spaces between the soil particles, and that one makes it be less porous? And for the case of loam soil, for it is moderately porous. Let's move to air content. Now, because of the spaces, we realize that sandy soil contains a lot of air, so it is well aerated. Then for the case of clay, it contains little air, and that one makes it to be poorly aerated. And this is due to the presence of small spaces between the particles of clay soil. Let's move to drainage of water. Students, can you ask yourself which soil has good drainage, which one has poor drainage, and why? So we realize that sandy soil has good water drainage, clay soil has poor drainage, and this one is about the spaces between the soil particles. Sandy soil has large spaces and clay has smaller spaces. For the case of loam, this loam soil for it drains water moderately. Let's go to water holding capacity, which is the same as water retention capacity. How much water does the soil hold? So we realize that sandy soil for it holds little water, so it has poor water retention capacity, and this can be improved by adding in humus. Remember, this humus can stick the sandy soil particles together, and of course by doing that they are going to be improving on the water holding capacity of the sandy soil. Then we have clay soil. This one tends to be waterlogged, like we had seen before. It holds a lot of water, and therefore for it has very high water retention capacity. Then when it comes to loam, it has moderate. Let's move to an experiment to compare drainage and retention in sand and clay soils. Now, when you look at this experiment, we have two experiments in one. Experiment about drainage and experiment about water holding capacity. So we need the materials. Which materials do we need, students? The very first material we need, we have two filter funnels, we have two measuring cylinders, we have two filter papers, we have two equal volumes of dry sand and clay soils, then we have water, and then two beakers. Now, let's move to the procedure. The procedure, we shall measure equal volume of each soil sample. Think from the previous experiments which we have done, you know how to measure this. Then after that, we shall fold the filter papers properly. We shall fold, assuming this is my filter paper, I will fold it properly, and after folding, you put it in one filter funnel and the sand in the other. Wait a moment. Here we have said we fold filter papers properly and put one in each filter funnel. Remember, we had two. So we shall fold one, we put in one filter funnel, and then we fold another one, and then we also put in another filter funnel. After that, we shall place clay soil in the filter paper in one funnel and the sand in the other. Now, after that, we shall place the funnels with their contents over the measuring cylinders. We are going to see this on the next slide over there. So, in setup A on our left, we are calling that one setup A. Then on our right, we are calling it setup B. Now, after that, after you've placed the soil samples for sand in setup A, once you place that filter funnel with its contents into that measuring cylinder, you do the same to the contents of the filter funnel containing clay soil. Now, after that, we are going to pour equal volumes of water. we are going to pour equal volumes of water. And of course, after, we are going to leave this setup to stand for some 10 to 20 minutes. And then observe. Now, the next slide for this particular one, it is comparing the three soil samples, sandy soil, loam soil, and then clay soil. So let's move to the next slide where we are having observations. Now, when you try to come back here, you realize that in sandy soil, after that time has elapsed, we realize that we are collecting a lot of water. Loam soil, we are collecting moderately a large amount of water, but this one, you cannot compare it to the one we have collected in sand. But now for clay, in clay we are collecting very little water. So what does it mean? Much water has been collected in, has remained in clay soil. Then loam soil, for it has retained moderate water. For sand, it has almost lost all the water which was placed there. Now, let's go to the observation. We realize that water passes through sandy soil faster than any clay. I think we have seen that. So much water is collected in the cylinder with sandy soil, and less water is collected in the cylinder containing clay soil. So we can now look at which explanations can we give for this. Sandy soil, like we said before, has larger air spaces which enable water to pass through, to drain through more rapidly. And then on the other hand, for the case of clay, for it retains more water. In other terms, for it is going to collect small amount of water in the cylinder, just because for it has so many particles that are packed together, so that soil has very small spaces, and those spaces will only allow small amount of water to pass through it. Now, in our conclusion, we can say clay soil holds more water than sandy soil, and sandy soil drains faster than clay soil. So what does this conclusion mean? Clay soil has good water holding capacity than sandy soil. And sandy soil has good drainage than clay soil. Can you imagine? Now let's move to the next slide. This slide, we will try to watch some video on YouTube. It is talking about that experiment which we have been discussing. Now let's go to capillarity through the different soils. Capillarity through soil means how well can water rise up in the soil. And this also depends on the size of the air spaces between the soil particles. Have you seen how the size of the air spaces can do a lot of work? Now, sandy soil has the lowest capillarity of water, while clay soil has the highest water capillarity, but loam, for it, has medium water capillarity. An experiment to demonstrate and compare capillarity through sand, clay, and loam soils. We need the materials. The first material, we have the three capillary tubes. We have one glass trough, we have cotton wool, we have three retort stands, then we have samples of soil for clay, sand, and loam. Let's go to procedure. Now we are going to begin by putting cotton wool at the bottom of the capillary tubes. Now, assuming this is my capillary tube, I get cotton wool, I put down at the bottom this side. So we shall have enough space from this upper part of the capillary tube. Now after that, we are going to fill one capillary tube with sample of dry sandy soil, and pack it. We shall fill it with soil, and after we pack it to ensure that there are no spaces in the soil. Now after that, we are going to repeat the procedure we have done on this particular capillary tube with the other soil samples for clay and the loam soils. Now the capillary tubes are going to stand vertically. They are going to stand vertically with the cotton wool immersed in the water, in a trough containing water. with cotton wool, that end containing cotton wool, is the one which is going to be immersed in a trough containing water, and then those capillary tubes are going to be supported by the retort stands. We are going to clamp retort stands, three of them, on each capillary tube to ensure that they are vertically supported. Now, after that, of course, we are going to leave the setup to stand for some 20 or 30 minutes. Now, what will be our observations at the end of this particular experiment? Can you imagine water rises faster for a short distance? Listen attentively. Water rises faster for a short distance in sand soil. Where in clay, water slowly but to higher distance. In loam soil, water rises moderately. We are seeing that in loam soil, we are having moderate. So for it, it is in between sand and clay. Okay, in our conclusion, we shall see that clay soil has the highest capillarity of water than sandy soil. So sandy soil is going to have moderate, and for the case of loam soil, the sandy soil is going to have the lowest capillarity, and then for loam soil, it's going to have moderate capillarity. Now, when you look at this slide, we realize that when you look at clay soil, for it, the water has moved to a greater distance, followed by loam, and then lastly in clay. Now, let's go to the explanations. We explain why is it like this. Water rises to the greatest height in a sandy soil. Remember, I told you that for the case of sandy soil, water is going to rise very fast to a greater height compared to clay soil. But remember, for it, the water is going to move to a very high distance, which is not the case in sandy soil. Now, water rises to the greatest height at the nearest stages of the experiment in sandy soil because sandy soil has large spaces that enable water to rise. It has large spaces. And then for the case of clay soil shows the highest rise of water, hence the highest water capillarity, because for it, it is composed of tiny soil particles which presents the large surface area over which the water molecules can cling. Remember, I told you for the case of clay soil, it has small soil particles which are packed together. Now, as this water is moving, that water is going to cling on those soil particles, and eventually we are going to see that clay soil is going to have high water capillarity. The water is going to rise to a greater distance just because of that. These small soil particles, they are going to present a large surface area over which the water molecules are going to attach themselves, and that in that process they are going to move to a greater distance, greater height. Now, water rises at a slow rate in clay soil because clay soil has small air spaces between its particles. Now, remember when I was comparing sand soil and clay soil, I told you in the first few minutes, water is going to move very fast compared to clay soil. But remember, clay soil, for it, is going to have the highest capillarity than the sandy soil. The reason is why this clay soil, in clay soil, water moves at a slow rate just because there are small air spaces in between the soil particles of clay. Now let's move to the chemical properties of soil. We have two major chemical properties. We have soil color and then soil pH. Soil color, this determines the amount of heat that can be trapped in a soil sample. Now we realize that darker soils, for them, they retain more heat than the right soils. Darker soils, they retain more heat than the light soils. Now, soil pH. This is the degree of acidity or alkalinity of the soil. Most soils in tropics are acidic, but some are alkaline. pH affects the rate at which mineral salts, e.g. nitrogen, phosphorus, iron, are absorbed by plants. Remember, these plants, they do well in different soils because of the soil pH. So you realize that some of these minerals, they may not be available in some soils. So most plants grow best in slightly acidic or neutral soils. Now, this next slide is trying to show the different colors of the different soils. So we have those different colors. Okay, now let's go to an experiment to determine soil pH. We shall begin by talking about the materials. So we have fresh soil sample, distilled water, universal solution, and indicator pH. Sorry, the pH indicator chart. Now, let's begin by looking at the procedure. What are we supposed to do in this particular experiment? We are supposed to do the following. We are supposed to place about 3 grams of soil on a petri dish and soak it with universal indicator. Now, after that, we are going to leave this for about 2 minutes. Now, once that time elapses, what are we supposed to do? You tilt the petri dish. You tilt the petri dish so that the indicator drains out of the soil, and then compare the indicator color with the indicator chart. Now, in that particular case, after those two, we are supposed to compare. We get the color we have gotten from our experiment and we compare it with this pH chart. So, from this pH chart, we realize that we have this part which is showing the acidity, and then we have this other part which is showing the alkalinity. Then we have that middle part where we have the neutral point. So when you compare and you see that it is reading 7, it means that that soil has neutral pH. Then when it is going to this other side, I think when you try to watch on that side, we see where the acidity is going. It means that that particular soil is acidic. Then when we try to go to this other side, from 7 to around 14, we realize that that soil is alkaline. So when we have 7, that is neutral pH, then from around 7 point something to that extreme end of 14, that is alkaline, then from around 7 point something to this other side, that is acidic. Now, students, in this lesson, we have discussed so many things. Please don't forget, we have looked at soil living organisms, importance of soil living organisms, experiments to investigate the presence of soil living organisms. We have talked about types of soil. Don't forget clay soil, loam soil, and sandy soil. We have also discussed the differences between the different types of soil. We have also looked at the different physical properties of soil, where we talked about porosity and the rest. We have also looked at experiments about the physical properties of soil. Please, students, don't forget to summarize that information. We have also discussed something concerning the chemical properties of soil. I want to end here, but before I end, I want you to read something concerning soil erosion, soil fertility, and conservation, because Mr. Ejonai is going to be coming to say a lot of information concerning those key areas, soil erosion and soil fertility and conservation. So please, members, as you are doing some other domestic work, don't forget to listen to these videos. They are going to help you so much. We thank you so much, and we hope we are going to be seeing you soon. Please don't forget to keep yourself at home. Don't forget to wash hands, and if possible, you can even sanitize. Thank you so much for listening.